Welcome to Pathway Church Online. My name is Jason. Have we got a service for you? Mission statement here at Pathway Church is this: to reach people far from Christ and help them become devoted followers of Him. If that's you today, you're at the right spot. Thank you so much for being here. If you're joining us for the first time, awesome to have you. And if you're here normally, great to have you back. Be sure to like and subscribe to this channel. One quick announcement before we dive into worship, and that is this: starting next Sunday, October 1st, Pathway Kids will now be in both the 9:15 service as well as the 11 o'clock service. So that's some pretty triumphant news. Scrum True Lesson. Today, Pastor Nate is bringing us part 3 of our We Are the Church series. And this message is entitled, What Do You See? You know, there are so many different types of people in the church. And we get to pinpoint who we are and who other people are and how to treat each other with respect and dignity and love. So, we're going to dive into some worship now. Before we do that, let's give this time and attention to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church. Thank you for this online community. We ask you to bless each and every one of them viewing online. And God, we give this morning to you. We give this hour to you. And just take this service. And people who may be watching for the first time, might they feel your presence even through this internet. We love you. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again. This is for you. In your name, amen.
Remember those walls that we called sin and shame? They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But He came, and He died, and He rose. Those walls are up on now. Remember those giants we call death and grave? They were like mountains that stood in our way. But He came, and He died, and He rose. Those giants are dead now. Sing. This is our God, this is who He is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what He does, He saves us. Before the cross beat the grave, let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away, faith so weak that we could barely pray, but He heard every word, every whisper. And now those giants in the wilderness that tell the story of His faithfulness. Never once did He fail. This is what He does, He saves us. Before the cross, beat the grave, let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. He pulled me out of that pit, He did, He did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Jesus, who rescued me from that grave? thousand times I failed, your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fate.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. Today, we're in week three of our four-week fall series called We Are the Church. And I want to invite you just to say that together with me. We are the church. We learned in week one that the church is not an organization. It's not a corporation. It's not a denomination. That the church is the people of God. And not just all people. There's a specific people that are the church. And we learned that those who follow Jesus, they are the community that is called the church. And so we as a church, a Pathway Church, are a community of people who are following Jesus, seeking to listen to him, obey him, follow him, to live and love like him, and to trust in him. And as we move together, we are Pathway Church. In week two, we learned that we actually follow Jesus through the good times and the bad. No matter what happens, we trust in God and continue to move forward. Today, what I want to do as we continue our message series is I want to read a story that's found in Mark's gospel. And there's another account of it in Matthew, but I really want to read Mark's account of this story. And it's the story of Jesus healing a paralytic, a man who can't walk. And so I want to just kind of read the whole story. And then we're going to circle back and ask kind of, what do we see here? And as I read, I'm going to stop and fill in some blanks, but I will put up the scriptures here to my side, and you can just follow along as we walk through it. It says this in Mark chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. And when he, Jesus, returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. Jesus is visiting a friend, family member. He is not doing ministry. This is not church. This isn't like a synagogue gathering. Jesus is visiting a friend or at home with someone. And it says that many were gathered together. Word spreads that Jesus is in town. People start showing up. Next thing you know, the living room's full. The kitchen's full. Outside is full. They're looking in the doors and windows. So this huge crowd is gathered together so that there's no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. I think it's really interesting to note that all these people show up. They all have needs. I'm sure many of them needed to be healed, needed encouragement. And Jesus decides that what they need most is his word, which we're going to talk about today. And they came bringing to him a paralytic, someone who was unable to walk, carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. So imagine this. Jesus is teaching in the house, standing room only. Next thing you know, the roof is opening and they're lowering this paralytic down in front of Jesus. Now, when Jesus saw their faith, the faith of the friends, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some of the scribes are sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they were thus questioning within themselves, said to them, "Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise, take up your bed, and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home." And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, I love this, "We never saw anything like this." Well, this is an incredible story, and I love how it ends. The people are amazed at what Jesus has done, and they're like, "We have never seen anything like this." Now, we've been talking about how we are a church, and we're a church of those who follow Jesus. And I wonder what it would be like if we could be a church where people came and when they left, they said, "We've never seen anything like this." Right? Imagine if we could be a church where people are carried in and they walk out, where people come in and leave totally transformed by the power of God. That's the kind of church we want to be. And so here in this story, we have this large crowd gathered, and they're all there to see Jesus, to experience Jesus, to get something from Jesus. It's a lot like church. And one of the questions I want to ask today is, what do you see? What do you see in the story? What kind of people do you see? We all look at things differently and we all notice different things. I remember this photo. I'll throw it up on the screen beside me. But this photo, let me ask you a question. What do you see in the photo? Some people claim to see the face of an old woman, while others claim to see the face of a young woman who's turning and looking behind her. Which do you see? And it's amazing how different people will see different things. And today, as we look at the story of Jesus healing the paralytic, I want us to consider what we see in this story. Because again, as all these people are gathered to get to Jesus, just like we do on a Sunday morning, there's all kinds of dynamics going on. It says this, many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. This is a standing room crowd only. Now, what do you see when you come to this church? If you're new to Pathway Church, right? If you're new here, if you're new online, if you're new in person, let me ask you a question. What do you see? What do you notice when you come into this church? You might assume, if you're new to church altogether, you might assume that everyone in this church has got it all together. You might assume that we've got it figured out, right? That nobody here has any issues they struggle with, that nobody here has relationship problems, that nobody here struggles with addiction, that nobody here is melting down financially. You just assume everyone has it all together. Well, I would say, don't assume that everyone has it all together, because the truth of the matter is, all of us, as we follow Jesus, are in a process. We've been learning about that. We are all taking steps in Jesus' direction. And as we do, Jesus calls us to let go of some things and to change and to be more like him. And so we're all in this transformation process. Second thing, really important to note, don't assume that everyone is here for the same reason. You might just assume that everyone's here for Jesus. And of course, maybe they are, but everyone's here for different reasons. You know, maybe you're here because you are desperate for God. Maybe you need God to show up in your life, and that's why you showed up today at church. But for someone else, maybe you're only at church, watching church online, because your spouse wants you to, and you're trying to fix a situation, or maybe because your parents expect you to be, or maybe because you feel obligated to do it, or maybe you're trying to meet somebody special, or maybe you're trying to build your Tupperware sales, or everyone comes to church for different reasons, and that's the truth. So don't assume that everyone's here for the same reason. What do you see when you look at Pathway Church? I know when I was a kid, I grew up in church, and we often assume that kids miss stuff, but as a kid, I noticed all kinds of things, maybe that adults didn't notice. I remember seeing people in the church who cared so deeply for others, who sacrificed and served, and nobody seemed to notice, not even the pastor sometimes. And I remember as a kid seeing them and going, man, I want to be like that lady. I want to be like that man. I want to be the kind of servant that does those kinds of things. And then I saw other people who maybe were on the stage or maybe were out in front, had a big title, and you could just tell that they were just pursuing power and being visible in the church. I saw both of those things existing together. I remember seeing people who prayed for others and encouraged them. And I saw other people who criticized and gossiped and talked behind people's back. I saw both of those things in the church. I remember seeing people who were healed and changed, like within a few years, their whole life radically transformed by the power of Jesus. And then I also saw people who were in the church for 20 years and never changed a bit, right? So I saw all of these things. Wondering what you see when you look at the church. Jesus, it's interesting to me that when Jesus sees this crowd of people, and my guess is that the people that were there, they all wanted something different from Jesus. Some of them wanted a healing. Some of them want Jesus to help them with the situations. They all wanted something from him. But when he saw the people, I find it fascinating that Jesus decided to preach to them. Right? It's like, well, Jesus, what about all our needs? And Jesus is like, actually, what you need most is my word. What you need most is my word. You know, it's interesting to me that most of us tend to focus on our immediate pressing needs. I need financial help. My relationship's in trouble. You know, I need this or I need that. And what Jesus actually brings to the people is his word. And you go, well, words, how are words important? Well, God created the universe with his words. That's how powerful words are. Not only that, but like the fact that you and I can walk on the streets, that we can own a home or a car, and someone else can't come up and go, that's mine. And the reason why they can't is because there are laws in place, there are documents, and they're all made with words. Some of those laws were written many generations before us, and those words have power over our lives. And Jesus comes on the scene, and he speaks his word to us, and his word is actually the thing that outlasts everything else. And so he gives them his word. That's so amazing. Now, today, as we look at our story, I'm just going to kind of recap what we've just read. And I want you to see that there are four kinds of people in the story, which is really interesting because just a couple chapters later in Mark 4, Jesus is actually going to talk about how the kingdom of God is like a sower who goes out and sows the word. And he says that these seeds, his word, lands on four different kinds of people, which is It's fascinating that we're going to see four kinds of people in this story as well. The four kinds of people that hear Jesus' words are those with hard hearts who reject it. No way. Those with shallow hearts who go, this is amazing. Yes, I'll do it. But then inevitably, when things get hard, they disappear. The third group are those who are thorny ground. And what that means is the cares of this world, money, career, family, all the good things around us, they start to choke out what God's doing. And ultimately, it comes to nothing. And the last group of people were those who had a good soil and what the word that was planted in them grew and became fruitful. So today in our story, we're going to see four different kinds of people. The first kind of people we're going to see are people in need. And of course, our thoughts should obviously go to the paralytic, right? So this is a man who is unable to walk. His friends have to carry him to where Jesus is because he is unable to get there himself. Now, of course, this is difficult, and there are people in our modern context who are in the same situation, although I would argue that perhaps his situation was a bit worse, because today, even if your legs don't work, you can still have a job, you can use technology, computers, there's wheelchair lifts, there's all kinds of helps and supports, where in those days, he was pretty much resigned to be a beggar. Not only that, you pair that also with the fact that in their culture, they believed that if you had something like that wrong with you, that it was a punishment from God, that you had probably done something wrong. So there was a stigma attached to his physical challenge. And so he lived with all of that. And so we have this man coming to Jesus who is in need. Now, it's interesting, over the years as a pastor, I get to talk to lots of people in my day-to-day life. And usually I'll meet people and we get chatting about sports or family or whatever it is. And at some point in the conversation, they'll ask me what I do for a living. And when I say I'm a pastor, it gets super awkward, okay? Often what happens is they start apologizing for words that they used previously in the conversation, and then they kind of clam up. And on occasion, maybe I should get one of those white collars, you know, and just let them know up front. Anyways, inevitably what happens is some of these folks that I'm chatting with will say something like, well, that's cool, but like, I would never go to church. And I'm like, oh, well, how come? And they say, well, church isn't a place for someone like me. And I'll lean in, I'll say, well, what do you mean by that? And I'll say, well, you know, I've done this or I've done that, or, you know, I'm not a good person, or I've got these challenges, so I don't belong there with the good people. And a lot of people feel that way about church. And unfortunately, they're quite mistaken, because Jesus actually said the very opposite. In fact, a few verses later in our story, Jesus is criticized for having lunch with tax collectors and prostitutes and people who are on the outskirts of society. And when he was challenged, he said this in Mark 2, verse 17. He said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but I came to call sinners. So Jesus actually says, you know what? I didn't come for people who have it all together. I came for those who are struggling, who are hurt, who are broken. So when you ask, well, who's the church for? The church has to be for those who are struggling, hurt, and broken, not for perfect people. In fact, one of the things we discover as we read the scriptures is that if we have it all together, we won't depend on Jesus. And that's something that each and every one of us needs to do. Sometimes people come to church and they say, oh, you know, I'm a moral person. I'm kind. I'm generous. I'm actually here for my husband or my wife. I'm bringing them. You know, my kids, my teenagers, well, they need some Jesus. You know, but I got it together. And when we buy that lie, we don't trust in Jesus the way we ought to. The truth is, the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, which means every single one of us has fallen short. That every single one of us, in essence, requires a Savior. That every single one of us is, for all intents and purposes, the paralytic, the one on the bed, needing to be saved, needing to be forgiven, needing to be helped. And honestly, no one comes to God without first acknowledging their need for him. Nobody. So that means that every single one of us finds ourselves there if we're truly honest. In verse 4, it says this, and when they could not get near him because of the crowd. This to me highlights the second group of people. We got people in need. And then the second group of people we have are the people who are preoccupied. Preoccupied. There's this whole crowd of people gathered around, okay? So imagine church. Everybody's there. They all got their seats. They're all standing in the doorways. Everyone's there. They want to hear something from Jesus. They want to ask him a question. They're there for something for themselves. And it also amazed me that you have somebody who's in such great need. So here are these four guys carrying a paralytic. And they're like, hey, can we get through? And people are like, no, no. This is my spot by the window. I'm Jesus in the middle saying something. No, no, leave me alone. And so they're trying to get to Jesus and they can't, which is crazy because there are people who are preoccupied standing in the way. And I've noticed after growing up in church for my entire life that often the biggest obstacle to getting to Jesus is other needy people. That's just true. And so you come to church and you expect a certain thing to happen. And what you discover is that there are other people standing in the way. It makes me wonder sometimes if I'm standing in the way of other people coming to Jesus. And I remember as a young person going to youth group and everyone was kind of huddled up and I'm standing by myself and wondering why nobody came to greet me. And I didn't understand at the time that everyone was just so nervous themselves and they're all just trying to find their own people and find their own comfort that they didn't include me. And so I felt like that. If you felt like that, then you know what I'm talking about. And so I'm wondering why they don't do something and they're wondering why I don't do something. And then I go, man, these people don't care about me, and I leave, right? People get in the way. People who are preoccupied with their life, preoccupied with their faith. And I would just like want to encourage you with this. Don't let people keep you from getting to Jesus. And I love that in this situation, the friends of this paralytic man, they don't stop, but they're going to get him to Jesus no matter what. And that leads us to our third group of people that we find in our story, and the third group of people that I know we find here in our church if you look for them. And they are people who care, people who care. They came bringing him a paralytic carried by four men. Honestly, people who care are essential for the church. In fact, it's what the church should be about. And the truth of the matter is that if all of us have issues, then all of us at some point will need to be carried by others. And that's not always the easiest thing to do. In fact, if I were in the story, I would much rather be the friend lifting him up onto the roof than be the guy in the cot being lowered down into Jesus's space. I remember years ago I suffered a concussion and I got dizzy, fell over, hit my head off a chair. And when I woke up, a nurse was helping me. And I was like, oh no, I'm fine, I'm good. I couldn't see straight. My head was, everything was dizzy. I was disoriented, I was in pain. But I was like, no, I'm fine. They sat me down to watch a volleyball game my son was playing. And I was probably watching the wrong court, to be honest with you. I was so out of it, but everyone kept asking me and I said, I'm fine. And the truth of the matter is so often in church, people walk around going, I'm fine, when nothing could be further from the truth. And sometimes what we need most are friends, people who care, people who come alongside and carry us for a little while so that we can get back on our feet. That's one of the things that the church is supposed to be. And of course, if we want to have friends like that, we have to be a friend first. It's important that we learn to invest and care for others and then we care for one another and lift each other's burdens. The story continues and we see them not giving up. And it says, when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let the bed down on which the paralytic lay. It's easy just to read this, but in my crazy brain, I like to imagine. So they're hauling him up the side of the house. Imagine this. They get him up on the roof. And you remember, there's like a church service going on inside. Jesus is preaching. All the people are packed in there. Next thing you know, they're cutting through the roof. Right? Jesus is talking in there and the sower sows the word and he's in there doing his thing. And next thing you know, there's sawdust coming from the ceiling. A crack of light comes through. Next thing you know, a head pops through. We're in the wrong spot. He's over there. You know, and they move over and they start cutting another hole. And eventually, once they get a hole cut, I mean, nobody's listening to Jesus anymore. Everyone's looking up. And next thing you know, this guy starts getting lowered down. You know, of course, it's not going to be smooth. He's going to be going this way. And he almost falls out and everyone's like, whoa. You know, you just imagine how this plays out. And Jesus is just watching the whole thing. And as this man comes down in front of him, he looks up and he sees the faces of the four friends looking down. They've done everything they can do to bring their friend to Jesus. And Jesus, seeing their faith, begins to interact with this man who is in need. Here's a question. Do you have people in your life that would do that for you? Here's another question. Would you be the kind of person who would do that for somebody else? who would care enough to do everything in your power to help them. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." What a statement. I can just imagine the friends with their heads down through the roof going, "Jesus, no, no. Like, we know he has sins, but that's not his issue. Look at his legs. Fix his legs. Heal his legs. Like, we had to carry him here. That's the issue." And Jesus says, no, no. His legs aren't his biggest issue. The biggest issue in his life and the biggest issue in yours and mine is sin. And Jesus says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." You know, God often gives us what we need before he gives us what we want. And I know we don't like to acknowledge this, but sin is actually the greatest problem. That war, famine, injustice, all of these things that we experience in this life, those are all rooted in sin. Rejecting God, pride, jealousy, anger, bitterness, resentment. These things that exist in the human heart are what cause so much of the tragic actions and results that we see in the world. And Jesus actually says the thing that needs to change most is the hearts of men. We need to be filled with his spirit and transformed so we think and act and we have different motives so that we're not the same people anymore. And so Jesus is actually addressing this man and he's working from the inside out. And of course, all of us are like, "But Jesus, I have an issue in my relationship. But Jesus, my body's sick. But Jesus, I need money. But Jesus." And he's like, let's deal with your heart. Let's start there. So they get him to Jesus. Now, Jesus says, "Your sins are forgiven." And immediately some stuff starts to stir. The religious leaders are there. And it says, now some of the scribes were sitting there. And they're questioning in their hearts. They're wrestling with the things that Jesus is saying. And they ask, "Why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. He's leading everyone astray. This isn't true. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And so they're saying, well, if only God can forgive sins, how can Jesus be claiming to forgive this man's sins? Either he's claiming to be God and he's crazy, or he's teaching something that's false. And as they're wrestling with this, of course, Jesus realizes what's going on and he speaks directly to them and he essentially puts it to them. He says, well, if forgiving sins can only be done by God, which it can, and if making this man's legs work again can only be done by God, which is easier? And Jesus says, so that you know that I have the power to forgive sins, I'm going to heal his legs too. And he says, rise and walk. Everything I love about this story, his friends had to carry him there. And he walks out carrying his own mat. And when we're talking about being the church, one of the things I want you to know as a pastor here at this church, I want you to know that our goal for you and for me and for every person that attends this church is that we would grow to become more like Jesus. That if we walk in broken, that we at some point walk out healed. That if we walk in distress, that we leave with peace, that something changes when we interact with Jesus. That's the goal, right? So yes, church is for the broken and the hurting, but it's also supposed to be a place of healing and strength and forward momentum. This is crazy. So we got the fourth group of people, right? Here's the fourth group of people, people who are critical. Now, I don't have to spend a lot of time talking about this today. We all know how easy it is to be critical. It's so much easier to criticize somebody than to carry them. You shouldn't have done that. Stinks to be you. Like, it's so easy to just point. It's so easy to cast judgment. It's so easy to push somebody aside rather than to carry them. It's easy to find fault. And it's hard to find common ground. So what do you see when you look at this church? Do you see people in need? Do you see people who are preoccupied just going on about their daily lives? Do you see people who care? Do you see people who are critical? The truth of the matter is, every single one of those groups of people exists in our community. In fact, I would even argue that every one of those four types of people exists even within my own heart on a given day, right? I can be caring and in the next moment I can switch to being critical, right? I can recognize in one moment my need and another moment I can be arrogant and be like, I don't need anybody's help. Like, We move constantly between these different types of people. And so what kind of people do you see? And here's the real question. What kind of person will you be? See, as we go forward as a church, if we are the church, then each one of us gets to decide what kind of person we're going to be. And it actually begins with each of us acknowledging the fact that we are broken and needy and in need of a savior. And then we get to choose to be the kind of people who serve and care for those who are hurting and in need of healing. The truth is that we are all somebody in need. The truth is that we can all make a difference if we become someone who cares. And we are all being people who are changed as we follow Jesus together. So today, as we wrap up and pray together, I want to just ask you this question one last time. When you look at the church, what do you see? And when you look at yourself, ask the question, what kind of person am I going to be? Am I going to be somebody who cares? Am I going to be somebody who continues to move towards Jesus? Am I going to let people stand in my way? Am I going to be pointing out the problem, or am I going to be part of the solution? And so as we go from this place, we ask God to help us to grow, to strengthen us in our faith. Would you pray with me today? Heavenly Father, thank you for every person that attends Pathway Church, both online and in person. We pray, Father, that through this message series, that in the weeks ahead, you would continue to call each and every one of us as your sons and daughters to continue to grow in your direction, to become more like you. God, I pray that you would help us to see not only the bad stuff that happens around us, but to notice the good, to notice the people who care, who pray for, who encourage. God, would you help us to set aside our criticism and help us to be people who care? Would you help us to continue to grow towards maturity as we love and serve others around us? God, I pray that as we go forward from this place, God, that you would help us to become all that you've called us to be formed into the image of Jesus, your Son. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Grandeur, this quake before, moved by the sound of his voice, seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it, far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. In this mountain that's in front of me, we'll be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, with my soul. Yeah. it all, through it all it is well. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you, it is well with me.
Thanks so much, Nate, for that message. Powerful, descriptive, educational, all of the above. Right now, I'm going to put something on the screen for you. It is our financial update. It kind of shows you where we are at as a church. And a lot of this has to do with your guys' support and generosity. So thank you so much for your generosity, for giving to this church. Obviously, it shows that it's working and we're making a difference in this world together. So again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. Here's the link below. If you want to continue to give to this church, like I said, it means the world to us. So there you go. And I believe that's it for me, folks. Thanks so much for joining us. It's been a real swell morning, and hope to see you again next time. Have a great day. Bye.